Hello to everybody. We are in France, so I will just start saying two words in French. Then we're gonna switch to English. Is it good? Bienvenue à tout le monde. On se retrouve ici pour la conférence finale de COP 21. On est super ravis de vous voir. On est un tout petit peu fatigué. C'est un moment très émotionnel pour nous. On a travaillé pendant 5 semaines. Tout ça, vous allez regarder dans le pavillon, il y a une exposition qui raconte notre travail, elle montre les produits finants. Et tout ça, ça ne pouvait pas se passer si on n'avait pas le partenaire, non seulement financier, académique, institutionnel, mais aussi toute la communauté qui n'était pas ici, qui était dehors, qui était sur Internet. Donc pour tout ça, je vous remercie beaucoup. Maintenant, on va continuer en anglais. Donc, je passe le micro à vous.
Merci beaucoup. So, while that might be the first contact with POC 21 for some of you in the room, I would like to share our little story briefly with you, or at least my personal story, how this all came to be, basically. Came to being in almost 3 years ago, I think Daniel and me, on a way too hot summer day in Berlin. We're pretty set up, fed up and frustrated with our work. We mainly did for NGOs and consulting and communication area, and had the feeling of there were some, I don't know, we read some newspaper and there were some extraordinary bad new news about climate change and how it all escalates more quickly than anybody thought and stuff like that, and we felt really, really that this is our topic in a way, but we didn't know how to tackle it. It felt like the work we do is okay, but it's not probably the way to make the most out of this one lifetime we were given. Maybe there are more to come, we don't know currently. I calculate with this one. Is that off? I think so. No? Yeah? Okay, it's better. Yeah, and basically the very, very first idea back then was somehow we would need to unite people who work on maybe parts of a potential solution, and it needs to focus more on citizens in a way, because the big systems are part of the solution, obviously, but this is not where we can have impact in at the moment. And it was just this basic idea of something needs to be done different, but it was like roughly, I don't know, 9 months later, roughly, I would say, with other people in Berlin joining in, Kari and Simon and Max, for example, where it really became a concept thing that we founded a company on, actually, and yeah, went through hell and back trying to conceptualize what exactly it could be and what's the right phrasing for it and what could be the story behind, and like trying to find the way to professionalize that, basically, that it could become interesting to other people. Yeah, but we didn't succeed at all. So it was a long, long, long try, roughly a year in parallel to our actual work, over the weekends and many beers at night, to try to make sense out of that and make it more clear and easier to understand and easier to communicate. And at some point we met Ben and Justina in at a WeShare Fest, I think, and actually it was like colliding they were working on something similar and had similar ideas in their mind. And when then we understood basically that this year COP 21 will take place in Paris, it was the storyline was suddenly there, where we had all these hard struggles before to find how to put that out, how to reach out to partners that we would need for that, and what could be like the story, the spark. It was clear that in the uprun to this huge mega event, there might be a short window in time where we could make that maybe happen. And from there, now we are 1 year further down the road, roughly, and I'm standing in a stunning French castle in the middle of France, and yeah, I have the most amazing team with me I could think of, because I'm clearly always with a tendency towards utopia and idealism, so I need these people who ground me and say, wait a minute,
how do we do that actually? Yeah, we always kept going, whatever happened, and no money made for the most, like for till now, basically. But we won many, many, many super powerful and interesting partners. And it was really a high-speed experience for us. I'm standing here with roughly 30 members of open source hardware projects who we were sharing and living together here with for over 5 weeks. Actually, there are people I admired before and now call friends. And yeah, and then the media, of course, helping us or enabling us to spread a message of a more sustainable lifestyle, where we did the proof of concept, what is actually the name of POC. So I'm really, really happy to be here and live that moment right now together with you, and to see you all celebrating that with us, because for us it's really the end of the first part of a very long journey. So there's way more to come. A lot of things are planned. You will hear about them more today also a little bit. And yeah, this is a seed, basically. It's the starting point. You will see today many things where we try to develop as far as we could within 5 weeks. Not all of that is perfect, of course. Not all of that can be currently compared with what you are used to get in MediaMarkt or in Walmart or wherever, because there is a whole different story behind, obviously. We only had 5 weeks. They had like at least the time after the Second World War to develop their business. But in general, what we see here is socially and technically the proof of concept for a more sustainable lifestyle is feasible and possible. We have all the parts, and we invite everybody to join us to keep developing on that. For us, this is basically the lifetime challenge. Okay, so thanks again for being here and joining us, and welcome to POC21. And to give you a little bit a first impression of what this was before and how this place transformed or started to be transformed into what you see now, we have prepared a first video which is especially about the setup. So enjoy that.
Okay, so I'm Ehab, which is EHAB, let's make it easier. And I'm the technical lead for all the infrastructure, which is electricity, etc., etc. Okay, the last week it was a little bit crazy. Did construction for the showers, we did construction for the kitchen. We did construction for a lounge outside in front of the chateau, in front of the terrace of the chateau.
Basically, we are building a structure from 30 tents, and this is all you can see around here. It takes about half an hour per tent if you're used to doing this. In the beginning, it was like 2.
Essentially, everything had been brought from outside, which means wood to make the building for the kitchen, for a small house, for the showers.
I just found some materials at the concert place in Paris, La Villette.
Yeah.
They are giving us tons of stuff, and so we are just unloading that.
We, like I said, we brought all the cables, all the electricity from outside. We bring CNC, laser cutters, 3D printer, and all this kind of maker stuff, which will be awesome. We bring also all the stuff of the kitchen, fridge, oven, etc., etc. And we built a whole kitchen from A to Z.
What are you building today? Tell us.
A bar.
Bar?
A lounge bar.
Awesome. What do you need for that? What did you do about it?
We need wood from the woods. Then we're probably going to make some sticking system with smaller pieces of ready-made wood. And then we're going to use all the stuff, the rubbish we found over there.
The average number of people for the construction week is 50 people. And like I said, all what we did it ourselves. And I say it myself, 1 week for construction is very short, but we did it. with a lot of fun, and we did have party also. So we did a lot of work, but we are keeping this spirit of fun and play and meeting people. In fact, the chateau is not used. So we clean everything, we put electricity everywhere, we put smoker detector in each room, we had a fire extension and mattresses everywhere, etc., etc. So factory is working, which is awesome. The kitchen is working. We are Friday, tomorrow it's the first day of the camp. We are ready, we are waiting for everybody to have a lot of fun and a lot of work.
My name is Andrea Bauer. I was here also part of this crazy journey. And I'm hosting the morning part of the conference. So now we dive into the content. So we're going to show you in the next four sessions what the 12 projects did and what is the outcome, what is their philosophy, and how they're going to change the system. We don't know. The first session is about. We have four sessions, and in each session, three projects are going to present themselves, and afterwards they're going to be a panel. And in the morning session, you're going to see Sansilla, Open Energy Monitor, Velo M2, Faircup, and Nautil and Showerloop. And in the afternoon session, which is then after lunch, lunch is from 1 to 2:30, they're going to present Solar Rose and BC Tractor, $30 wind turbine, acre owned food, and Biceps cultivatus. So let's start with the first session, which is called The Energy for All. Dominic gonna host it as a moderator, and the projects gonna present themselves. They think they show perfectly how to change your perspective on how open source can change your perspective on energy consumption. So I hand over to Dominic. Have fun.
Thanks, Andrea. Actually, that is only a super brief handover to the first project at Sansilla from Berlin. I almost was about to steal your tagline, so I leave that to you. I don't tell you what you're actually doing. Enjoy the moment. This is your crowd.
Thank you. So, welcome. We are Leonie and Vivien from the Sansilla team. So, what has a cultural outdoor event, an emergency situation such as an earthquake, or a refugee camp, or people in remote areas in common? They all need fast and easy to set up energy supply. And what do you do in such moment normally? You get a normal fossil run generator. But this generator needs fuel, is noisy and stinks. And once you run out of fuel, there's no energy anymore. So we came up with another idea. We built a portable source of renewable energies, and that's the pop-up solar generator Sansilla. It's easy to set up and doesn't need any experts to be mounted. Okay, in this case it does, but it doesn't need any expert to be mounted, and furthermore, it's a modular system that can be adapted easily to your needs. For example, this system you see there for the moment can provide electricity for 30 to 40 mobile phones and a fridge, But if you have other needs, you can easily adapt it by adding other modules. And on top of it, it has a really intelligent regulation system with an animation interface that makes you understand your personal energy consumption, that can you adapt it to your, that you can adapt your consumption to the system. So you become a part of the whole system.
Now you might ask yourself, where do we want to go to? We want to bring the energy to the people. This means we have one sunsilla here, and here's another one, and there are even more. And all together they can connect and grow up a network of energy supply. Because we are truly convinced that renewable energies are a great opportunity to decentralize and democratize the energy supply. And this is also why we are open source. Because this person here with a sunsilla might invent a water purification system and integrate it into the sunsilla. And the other person maybe comes up with a cooling system and then it joins it to the sunsilla. And I want a coffee system. So all together we can join and create an organic and diverse ecosystem of energy supply. Sunsilla.
Wonderful, thanks. Why we are so happy is not only because of the project, that might be a little over the top actually for people who are the first time here with us today, but because when we had several sessions where we tried to communicate the projects and everything was super bad, to be honest. So it's amazing to see the progress also on the way how stuff is presented, and some more practice and we will be there. It was awesome. Really, really nice. Okay, so then the next one project that is here actually already is, I think, in the market for like, you develop it for 4 years and since when actually selling stuff, or do you tell that anyways? Okay. Open Energy Monitor. Welcome.
Hello. So I'm Tristan. I'm from the Open Energy Monitor project. And as we know, if we're to avoid the worst of climate change, we need to see a revolution in our energy system over the next 20 years. By 2035, we need to fully decarbonize our energy system, move away from a fossil fuel supply. And that's already happening. But it's not very tangible. You can't see what's happening. You can't see where your energy is coming from. So I started the Open Energy Monitor project because I wanted to measure how much electricity I was using at home, where that energy was coming from, and how I could supply it from renewable energy. And this here is the Open Energy Monitor. You place it near where the electricity comes into your home, and you clip the blue sensor on the cable that comes into the house. And if you've got solar panels, you clip another sensor around the cable from the solar panels. And then with that, you can see that information on your phone or on your tablet or on a your laptop. And that helps to answer some questions like, when is my electricity coming from my solar panels or from my wind turbine? How much energy do I use? And how can I reduce my energy use? So over the last 5 weeks at PUC, I've been working at integrating the monitoring with a design tool that allows you to explore the effect of insulating your house and seeing what the possible energy savings are. This tool builds on the work that we've been doing with a cooperative in Manchester called the Carbon Co-op, who are insulating houses to use 70% less energy for heating. And the energy monitor as well is being used by many people around the world already. So all these tools are open source. And given the short timescale, we need to all be able to be involved in our energy system so that we can build the energy system that we'd like. Thank you.
Thanks, Christine. Okay, and then the third project around the topic of energy here at POC21 is Breelo M2. So welcome on stage. It's only you, or is Milena coming with you? Ah, it's only you, so welcome. Enjoy.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Florent de Genk from the Velo M2 team. So what is Velo M2 about? I'm waiting for my colleague. Okay. Imagine you want to do a cultural event in an open space. How does it work today? Today, basically you need energy. So how does it work today? You bring cars, you come with your diesel generator, and if it's possible, you plug in to the electricity grid. With Velo M2, we are trying to build an alternative for that. We provide an energy platform that can act as an energy generator. This is placed onto a cargo bike, and everybody that comes with a normal random bike to such an event can just plug in the system and generate the electricity. In this way, we can, as a community with your friends, produce the energy that you need as a community. Of course, in this system, we can also plug other sources of renewable energy. We could integrate our colleagues from Senzilla, and we could also monitor the energy use with the energy monitor that you just saw. This energy hub or platform can also be used for a lot of different applications. A few applications we thought about were a mobile fab lab, small street markets, and also small professionals who are working with a cargo bag, but for instance, a plumber who needs to recharge his tools can have this energy platform to do that. We want to grow. And this is why we are building the system open source, so that people can improve it and can come with new ideas of application and construct them. This is where we are going towards. What we have built here is an energy module that can provide the energy, and also two applications, a mobile fab lab and this open air cinema. We would like to invite you to participate, to come up with new ideas, to create your own applications, and to build this community together. Thank you. What do you imagine?
Stay here. You can stay here. For the panel. Okay, so these were the first three projects we had here at POC21, and all three of them were focusing around energy. So we would like to go with a little panel discussion, basically. So I invite the people back on stage or other members of the project teams. Actually, this really small for four people. I don't know if that works. I stand, okay. No, I think it will. It will be cozy like in the tents, guys. We can. All right, we do it like that. Is that actually in the camera when we are sitting? No. Is it? More or less, huh? Well, okay. So the first question obviously would be around your experience here. So what was the camp for? We are. what was the experience here for you? Maybe what was the best moment, or what did you especially benefit from being here? That would be interesting, I guess. More about the experience. Who wants to jump
A very big question. We are at the end of 5 weeks and I actually don't know what to answer to you, because whatever I answer, I will miss something. So, but it was great. It was a great opportunity for us to work 5 weeks in a group, to be on an island. There's no one around. There's no family calling or friends. And this is one side, and the other side is that there were so many opportunities and chances and people and experts on each field. So whatever you needed, I need a designer. There's just a designer around the corner, or I need someone who's good in CNC stuff. Yeah, that was awesome that all the experts were here on this short distance available.
I found it really inspiring seeing all the other projects working on in this field, and really enjoyed working with Zinzilla and Velo M2 on the monitoring. We had a lot of fun building a system for the Velo M2. It was also really great to have the design input, especially at the start of the first few weeks, where we were going through what the projects were and like how do we conceptualize and understand them understand them better. And there, it was fantastic having all this different input from disciplines that I guess I don't have experience in myself. I think that was really, really beneficial.
I think for our project, the main experience that we got is that we really rethought all our project, and that we could, with the help of all the people around here, have a more clear vision of where we wanted to go and really develop a project and not staying in the conceptual phase. And that was just the project part, but personally, I think the experience was so amazing, just only the feeling that we are not alone, that we are there with lots of other people with the same ideas, the same values, working together on an idea, prototypes and real solutions for a better future. And that's why I think this experience was so great for us.
Thanks a lot. That was feels actually a little bit strange as the moderator and co-founder of that of that project. It feels a little bit like you tell me how cool we are. Actually, we would have been going nowhere without you. I said it this morning down at the dome. What we could have done was basically building the dome and the exhibition structure, but we wouldn't have any content. So without the project, POC21 would not exist. Would be no reason to do that, and if so, it would be empty. Basically, what we offered was the frame, and you filled that. Thanks for that. So the second thing I would be interested, especially when we now maybe go a little bit beyond your actual project, what's your motivation? Either you keep it specific to your stuff, but maybe there's also some bigger story to tell. What drives you? That would be interesting, I guess. Especially energy, such as we've seen some of the presentations, it's such a core thing we actually have to tackle if we think about climate change. So, who wants to start? Other way around, maybe?
I think Tristan has a real good framework.
All one of you. Well, I guess given energy is such an important thing, and the scale of what we have to achieve in such a short time, I think it's this open source approach that gives us the empowerment to all take part in making that energy future happen, which is the thing that is, I guess, inspires me, or is the motivation. And I think all the projects here, we're sharing that idea and that sentiment of that it's about taking energy into our own hands and building the system that we want.
Well, as Tristan says, We feel responsible for our own part in this whole issue of the context of climate change and the change that's taking place in the world. And we feel that we have our little part to bring to the solution to build for better future. And for me, this is my primary motivation to do my part and to build together with other people for this common goal.
If I'm speaking for the project, I'm from Zanzilla, it's like the idea is like giving the power back to the people, but power in both ways, like electricity, but also like power the political way, because now the electricity comes from the socket, from the wall, and we don't actually know, we can see it. That's a problem of electricity, we can't see it. We can only see it on the bills that we pay each month, but it comes from somewhere and we don't actually know what's happening beyond that. And so we want to enable people of self-sustaining their lives, because it's a need everybody has. We could see it here in the camp. We need to go to the toilet, we need food, we need water, we need showers, but we also need electricity. And actually it was great in the camp, because sometimes the fuse blow up, and so we could see what's happening when there's no electricity. And that's the idea of giving knowledge to the people. And speaking on a more personal way, it's like we have 5 people in our crew, and we are friends for more than 5 years. We like to create stuff, we like to create cool stuff, and we like to create stuff that is part of a better world, maybe.
Wonderful. Now, actually, you kind of answered parts of my next question, so I would have asked you for vision, but I think I skipped that because that was part in there. So maybe a more critical one. What on your journey here, these 5 weeks, what things did you come across or find out that are a challenge to open sourcing energy? What are things that don't work so far? What are things that are not developed? What is something that somebody urgently should think about starting to do something? I guess there were some.
I guess there's quite a few components of the energy system that that would be great that we could look at. So, sort of going further down into like an open source inverter or charge controller would be a fantastic component. That would be, and then that whole. And then how you connect these different systems together. So, and what involvement do we have as citizens and communities in our electricity grids? Or I think there's massive potential for open source in all of that, and that we're at the beginning, as it were.
I think we don't have to convince you anymore of the utility of open source, of the power it got. Looking at what Linux has achieved, and for me the main challenge now is the communication, and that's what we saw here too. Our first communication was crap. We didn't communicate well about our project. People didn't get what we were doing. They thought, maybe you're building some stuff. No, it's more in a whole context. It's about sharing knowledge. It's about making concepts for with a vision, with values. And that's something we don't communicate yet, because it stays very technical, I think. And for me, that's one of the main challenges. So that's perfect, because you're all here taking these ideas and communicating it and getting in the world to let people know what it's all about.
I really agree with what Tristan said, is whatever level you look at, if you make it open source, but then you go one level deeper, there will be like components which are not open source. There's nothing to add to that. The problem about electricity is that lots of people are afraid of electricity because they think they can hurt themselves or they can crash something. So this is also a problem about open sourcing electricity or energy. We need to take the fear of the people away so that they really want to do something about it.
Great, thanks a lot. That was the first panel on open energy. It's really, really brief run through all the projects and then some more context besides the actual pitch. Actually, this is not planned, but I currently have the feeling that I would like to open up to like two questions maybe, if there are some. One. Hey, Christoph. And maybe not like brief answers, either all of them or all of you, or just keep it short and that we have some interaction.
I make it very short. We will make Sansilla really great and big.
I'll be continuing with the Open Energy Monitor, finishing to bring this design tool together with the monitor. Yeah, I'll keep it to that.
We just discovered the power of all this happening, so we will be working on our project and see where we can get this. Yes, definitely. We are going on because there is so much energy building up here that we have to continue this movement to create more ideas, more projects, and check out the exhibition. There are at least four ideas to continue this energy.
One more? You don't have to, it's just an offer, I had the feeling. Okay, so then that was the first part. And while we take our seat, we start with the second video, which is mainly about the creative process that we run here. So enjoy.
Basically, the first week was there for shaking them up, for saying, hey, nice project, but we are not here to develop that like it is, because then you could just do that at home. So we have all kinds of skill sets here and interesting people to mingle with and to rethink what you're actually doing. Basically, it's about supporting the projects with the whole support crew, which merges all kinds of skills from engineers to coders to architects to a lot of designers. And yeah, basically build our first prototypes now. So we start with iterating, and those are more like rough prototypes, obviously. So a lot of paperwork, a lot of woodwork.
It's interesting how each project is at a different stage of development, and that some of them still work very hard on making sure they are answering the right questions, because their initial assumptions, they might start from the wrong point, whilst others, they already have something that works, something that builds, but because of their skills, more technical, more engineering, more scientific, they struggle in explaining and in the storytelling part of what they are proposing.
The Autodesk Foundation is primarily focused on design for impact. That's what we want to see. We want to see people around the world really applying design skills for social, environmental results and impact. And one of the things that we've been doing here is working with the dozen teams that are here at POC21 to figure out how they can be designing things and building things with an eye towards impact. In the last 10 years, the kind of global maker movement has happened, the kind of spread of tools and access to tools. And in the last year, what I've been noticing is the way that that attention is now being turned towards design and solutions and really trying to create businesses or models where we're not just making for the sake of making, we're not just building up our skills, but we're actually turning those skills towards something productive.
I think, you know, and with other teams, I think we can just, you know, exchange a lot of ideas and a lot of knowledge, a lot of experience. Some people, you know, they also give you suggestions of, on how to improve the actual design. And yeah, I think, you know, there's so many people that you can, as a resource, you can ask. Everyone's really open, really nice, and very supportive. So it's like, it's amazing.
So this was the first session. The next session is on design for sustainable living. And in this session, the next three projects, I think, pretty perfectly showcase how you can build everyday products in a more sustainable way. And Justina will host or will moderate the next session. Yeah, so welcome, Justina.
Hello, so I will go on stage. hello again. So I'd like to invite first of the project who's going to have a little pitch. Fair cop, Mauricio. I let you the space on the stage.
So use the microphone. Yeah. Okay.
Do you want me to do it?
Yes, please. Maybe you can drink a little bit of that.
No.
So we start. Okay. Thanks for, you know, listening. Basically, you know, you see this kind of water. There's about 1 billion people who have to drink this kind of water. I'm sorry. About 1 billion people in the world that have access to this kind of water. It's not clean. It has bacteria and a lot of things, nasty things inside. And yeah, this is a very, very big problem. It's a global problem. And what we, the FERCA project basically is to develop a very small water filter that can filter bacteria and chemicals and that it can fit into a small plastic bottle. Here at POC, sorry, we'll be developing this design. It's a new design that has membranes inside. And these membranes filter the bacteria and also activated carbon that filters out the chemicals. So you can, for a very low cost, produce something like this, and then you can actually drink this water. The main goal of the project is to make a very low-cost item that can be distributed worldwide, and hopefully millions of people can use this. We've got like very small filters for like plastic bottles, but also for like a family, you know, in Africa and Latin America. And this can also be built into like a solar-powered small suitcase-sized filter that can filter water for a whole village. The vision of the project. Well, how this started is because I was born in Peru, and in the 90s we had a huge cholera outbreak. 10,000 people died in just a matter of weeks. Nobody knew why, but it was basically because the water was being contaminated. And even now, after so many years, 20 years, in developing countries, Latin America, Asia, if you travel there, you know, the main advice is not to drink tap water. So this is not only in Africa, where people have to dig wells to get water from the ground, but this actually is happening in urban areas. And in developed countries, in rich countries, we consume about 200 billion bottles, plastic bottles every year. And that's being thrown into trash. Only like 30% is being recycled. And yeah, this is a solution that would help in developing countries, but also in developed countries, in rich countries where people, you know, use bottled water With this, you can have tap water that maybe doesn't taste very well, and also filter out the chemicals like chlorine, fluoride, mercury, lead. And these are the models that we've been working here at POC. And the new research that in the next months we can do is try new materials like porous plastics and antibacterial plastics so that you can actually 3D print the whole filter. And yeah, I mean, that's the new research that I'm doing. And for the future, the next steps after POC is to launch a crowdfunding campaign. You don't need so much money to actually produce these filters. And so that, you know, between us, all of the people, anyone who's here and would be interested to help, you know, you can actually help by donating maybe 20 euros, get a filter and also give one filter to a poor family in Africa or Latin America. So.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I will invite Natalia. Ishka.
Hello, we are Gillian and Mishka, and we are part of Team Nautil. So you probably have noticed walking around the castle here, the nature is gorgeous around us, and some of us have been enjoying it very much, walking in the forest periodically during the camp. And nature can be beautiful, it can be relaxing, but it can also be very inspiring. For instance, if you compare a bird and our planes, there is a great difference. What if our planes were as light and silent as the birds? If you look also at the plants in the growing on the forest ground, and you compare it to the factories we have, which are polluting, noisy, ugly, what if our everyday product could grow as plants grow? Also, we had a lot of rain over here, and every morning we woke up with the smell of the soil after the rain. And what if processing our waste was like in nature, as simple as letting things decay and grow again? So basically, with 3.8 million years of history on Earth, life, animals, plants, microbes have developed many ways to live and stay on this planet. And as biomimicry practitioners, Gillian and I, we like to dig into that, try to get inspired by how nature works, and see how we can produce more sustainable systems, designs, strategies.
So, 3 years ago, we started to co-design a bio-inspired kettle. Sorry. And we took inspiration from four species, the Nautilus, the polar bear, the toucan, and also the termite, to make our everyday kettle more energy efficient. So we brought our designs here at POC 21, and thanks to the feedback of different experts, they drastically evolved. So you will see some of our experiments in the dome, but the journey to make the object real is going to be long, hard, with many challenges to face and to overcome. So this is, yeah, okay. So this is why we also worked on a platform, a platform called BioOpen, made to for designers and engineers. On this platform, they can meet and they can co-create, co-design bio-inspired and sustainable products and services. So, as pioneers of this field, we documented our work and our experiences in a diary, which we called À l'intérieur du Nautil. So we hope it can help the bio inspiration movement to grow, and we will make it available for you to download and print on demand websites as soon as possible.
So we'll just continue working on our concepts, share knowledge, and feel free to join if you feel inspired by nature too. Thank you.
The sound was a little bit weird. Is it good now?
It's good.
Okay, so I will invite Jason to present Charlo.
Okay.
Close, like this.
Okay. Yeah, I'm Jason, and my project's called Charlo. Two days ago, I found out that you can't drill glass, and this happened to our shower. Our project's been fraught with destruction and demons, but it's all right. I'm not sure why I showed this slide, but anyway, let's go on forward. So I've been, You can build a shower loop in 2 days, especially if you have Tim and Marius at your side. So these guys are awesome, and they've helped me visualize my dream thingy. Next slide. I can't remember my slides. So the shower is a shower that, like, loops your... Okay. Shower loop recycles your drink, your shower water. Wait, I haven't slept in, like, 2 days or something. Just give me a second. Okay, restart, reboot. I'll do it real quick. So the problem is that I like really, really long, hot, warm showers, but I want to be an environmentalist and do right by everything. So the best way to have long, hot showers and be good for the environment is to just loop your shower water and just reuse the same water over and over again. Right now it's per shower, but in the future it'll be better. So we use 10 liters of water, and you can shower for as long as you want. That's pretty much it. And we have these filters that, I'm awesome. Okay, so the we use sand activated carbon and ultraviolet light, to clean, filter and purify the water so that it's drinking water quality. And I keep forgetting the main thing, right? The main benefit is that if you reuse your hot your water that's hot in the beginning, you're saving a lot of energy, because instead of heating up a small volume of water or a large volume of water, you're heating up only a small volume of water by a little bit at a time. Can I see the next slide? Okay. You know, the thing is why I'm not good with the pitches and stuff is because I've been talking about this project for a really, really long time, and I'm kind of bored of it, and I just want to show you. So I just got the shower to work about like 20 minutes ago or something. So please come back to the dome and just look at it, and it'll make sense. It's very simple, and I don't need to explain it. You'll understand it. Thank you.
This is the kind of pitch we teach at POC. Okay, thank you, Jason. So now we're gonna go to the panel part. So we're gonna talk, if I can get the slide. Yeah, we're gonna tell you. So we're gonna have a panel with all the participants about design for sustainable living. So I will invite all the participants to join me on stage, and we're gonna squeeze in like Dominic did and talk a little bit more about how to design for sustainable living. test. It's the noise because I'm standing next to the speaker. I'm not the important one. Okay, so first of all, guys, thank you for being here. And so my name is Justina, you kind of know me already. My background is in design and architecture. So I'm gonna try to ask you a few questions about how do we design and how do we turn the ideas we have into something that is good for the environment, but also that people want. So the first question from my side will be, what is sustainable design for you and how can we, you know, read it in your projects?
For me, sustainable design involves a lot of, it has to be designed for people, so it has to be social. It's not just about technology or like a beautiful product, but it has to solve a really important problem.
I completely agree with Mauricio, but I would like to add, like, you have to give a vision to people also, kind of something kind of optimistic, because we always talk about like sustainability as a, or climate change as something fatal. You say fatal, fatalistic. But you can show them that you can design products, you can design organizations, something like that, in a good way, and in a way to give an optimistic vision of that.
For me, it's kind of about resilience and self-sufficiency. So I think if we can empower people to kind of rely on themselves, but also survive more on their own, then they're more sustainable and more, what's the word I'm looking for? Exactly. Independent, autonomous, and the financial aspect is a huge one of that. And like with my project, it's to like, you save money also, and then that frees up resources for other like-minded projects.
I would just add, I think I like your vision and I share it very much. In my opinion, one of the main problems right now in the objects we use, and mainly objects in this room are an example, is that we have them by like kind of crashing another population somewhere else, like all the intelligence system, for instance, mainly source their materials in like the South, global South, being South America, Africa. And I think by also relying more on self-sufficiency, on autonomy, we can have a design that allows everyone to be what they want to be and not having one part of the world crushing the others.
And what's your process? Because what you do is sustainable design. And I'm really interested in like, what is that for you and how you design it? What's the way, you know, the concept gets born in your head and how do you translate it? Is there a specific way that you could like teach others how to design in a sustainable way?
So what we try to do is to take this inspiration from nature, because again, just looking and observing how nature works, like the trees we have here, they have basically solar panels, which are the leaves, and they just source the materials within like 4 meters around their trunk. So they're kind of the example of a design also very interconnected with the other species around. So this is always a source of inspiration, and we try to formulate it in a sustainable way. So with this idea of maybe like, again, if we take the example of the tree, it mainly takes its materials from dead material from other living beings. So again, how can we, when we design something, source our primary material in waste from other objects we can locally source? So this is the kind of mindset, always trying to cross inspiration from life and sustainability together and see what we can do.
For me, it was about like making it very, very, very simple. Like, you know, develop the tiniest possible filter, for example. So that was the inspiration. I'm not a designer, but I had this idea in my head and I wanted to use it for myself. I mean, I do backpacking and mountain climbing and I want to drink clean water. But then I saw that there's millions of people who don't have access to it. And so maybe your personal experience can be applied to other people. I was born in a country that happens to have that problem. So that's maybe from personal inspiration you get also, you know, these ideas.
Okay, for me, I'm an engineer, an environmental engineer, and then so there's a lot of tools already available that help you assess your idea or like the technical validity of it and the environmental aspects. So to me, like that stuff kind of exists, and that's what I do. If I have an idea, then I'll try and do a bit of the math to see if it makes sense. And after that, if it makes sense, then it's just a really large amount of work to just keep going at it over and over again. And that's kind of what happened here at POC, like trouble, 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 but you just keep going and ultimately it'll work out, you know, or you, yeah.
We have the same vision. On biomimicry, but maybe I can add something. It's just that you can't transfer like life principles and human applications like that. It's not so simple. That's we have also to think to the use of the things, to the cultures and things like that. And maybe the best solutions in nature don't work in the human context. And that's a question of interpretation, or how do you? Yeah, how do you transfer that? And that's kind of the design process. You try to make the balance between the best solution and the best thing for people. And it's not always the best thing, but it's just, you have to deal with that.
And another question that I ask myself often is like, you know, there are products on the market, there is a shower on the market, there is a kettle on the market, there are filters. And how is your project different from what's already there, and could you maybe in some point explain what's the open source aspect of your project and what's its importance?
Okay, so what we try to do is a kettle that is drastically energy saving, and there are also other energy saving products around there, but we really like this idea of what's the story of biomimicry can tell and how people relate to the animals, and how they understand the animal features we have in the kettle, and it brings a whole new story behind it. My feeling, very honestly, after this camp is that our kettle is overcomplicated and super difficult and super expensive to produce, and it's only a kettle. So I know I don't share this necessarily this viewpoint with my colleague, which is way more optimistic. But in my opinion, this is what happens when biomimicry is not performed in the right way. And I think we should aim for way simpler solutions, as you mentioned earlier before. So we can just discuss that later. But so there is this tension to find between this very interesting storytelling and featuring and beauty and still being very simple and very efficient. And yeah, and the open source aspects, I think we struggle all of us with a lot of challenges, and if we can open the doors to the mentors, the supporters, but also the outside community and anyone interested to help us solve these challenges in a collaborative way, that's the way we're going to be the quickest and the most efficient.
Yeah, the project, I think it's unique because it's like the smallest format that you can possibly have, and that hasn't been developed, I think, maybe also for economic reasons. I mean, maybe it's not a very good business, so a big company wouldn't, you know, like to develop something like this, which comes down to the second point, and it's open. And the advantage of being open is that you save a lot of time, research, costs as well, to not only to develop it and to design it, but also to distribute it. A lot of people are going to support you if it's something that, you know, people see value in it. And basically, you don't have to have a huge marketing department or even research or, you know, we developed a lot of things here. So, you know, the openness of the project, I think that's the main component of it.
I kind of agree with that part that, like my project is the shower, so I know it can be better, and I know it could be better very, very quickly. I've spent, I don't know, maybe 5,000 euros or something kind of developing this kind of slightly revolutionary technology or something, but then it's taken me so long because I didn't have money to do it, and maybe other people can figure out how to do it, or like together we can figure out how to do it better and share the knowledge and just get it done quickly and like push it out there so that it's like useful for everybody. That's kind of my objective, just to get it out there.
The only thing I can add, and what I think it's very inspiring in what you're doing, before I get to the last question, or maybe if we have more time too, is that what you're doing is solutions that don't fit all. You know, there are solutions that have been crafted by you to the problems that you see. So it's basically not one size fits all, but it's a, you know, a personalized solution for thousands of problems that we have. And that's what open source, it's finding all those solutions for all the problems we have. I don't know if you agree, but I kind of see this as the biggest, you know, plus to what you're doing. Which brings me to the plus and minus that you already mentioned, is how did that camp help you or challenged you to develop what you came with? I will just put it up now, and what's happening later? The last question we had in the previous panel. I'll let you answer.
For me it was very easy because I had a huge hopes on 3D printing, for example. And the first night that I 3D printed something, I was really disappointed. And I was really, really sad and angry, and frustrated. But at the same time, 3 days later, because of the challenge with Daniel, who was, you know, doing the project lead, he kind of challenged me to have something ready by the end. And I started researching, and I found like new materials and new ways of 3D printing. So like porous plastics and antibacterial plastics. And that kind of opened up, you know, like a new research path, let's say. And that was here. I you know, also like developing different designs, different models, different ideas with Yanis, who was helping me a lot with the sketches. You know, different ways of doing some one product, then you come up with lots of ideas and it evolves. So for me, open source is about evolution. I mean, really, you can start with something, and then, you know, like so many people give ideas, give proposals. Maybe somebody heard about something else, and then why don't you do it this way? Or, you know, have you heard of this before? And then it evolves, you know, it's an evolution of, and that's, for me, that's the most important part of open source, like to create human evolution, like use technology, mix it with people, creative people, crazy people, people who don't take showers, because we also didn't take showers in the last 5 days, but, you know, and mix it with all these inputs, and at the end you have something really, really cool that works, so.
Like to point out that Mauricio sleeps the least out of anybody here. He's 3D printing stuff at like 3 a.m. and then at 4 a.m. and at 5 a.m. I don't know why I'm awake at that time too. Wait, what was the question again?
What were the challenges?
Oh, the challenges, yeah.
And what helped as well, not only the challenges.
Okay. The challenges and what helped was that every time I wanted to buy something expensive, you know, a couple hundred bucks for something, and then they said no. And then, I mean, not you guys and not everybody, but It was actually really good for me. I simplified my project a lot. I changed the design. It's kind of too long and complicated to explain, but like, yeah, okay, yesterday I was gonna cut and I broke the glass, and then it's like I need a new glass wall, so then I was gonna cut an acrylic sheet that maybe cost 300 euros, and then they said no, or like, you know, that's an expensive shower you're building, and like, okay, yeah, you're right. And then so then we started cutting some plywood, and like I don't know how much it costs now, but I think it's probably half of what the last one I made. So that's like real progress, and that's kind of what I want to do anyway. I want to make a really fancy, cool holographic box shower thingy that's later maybe. But yeah, that was really, really good. There was another part of the question though. Yeah.
For us, our first challenge was, I think, like the production cost. That's right, yeah. Because we use a technology which is really, really expensive, so that was not compatible with where we put the product. Like, if we want to give to people some sustainable products, but which are only accessible for a few, that's maybe not the best answer. So we tried to change the techniques, to change the way, yeah, it was designed from inside and also outside, just to make it more affordable, but it's still expensive. Yeah.
In my opinion, POC21 was for us kind of a crash test, in the positive way, in the way they use it in the car industry to see if the car really works. It means we had all these experts, like 100 people, design jury, looking at the product under each bit and saying, yeah, this won't work, this is too expensive, this is not a good shape, this. So we had to rethink it completely. And actually, this very thorough kind of test got me asking more like deep personal questions also, like, okay, why am I doing this? Why do I stick to that product? Why do I stick to this methodology? What are the roots of all this? And it was very, very instructive, not very constructive in the way that we don't have a prototype in the tent. We have not been as far as we wanted to go, but maybe it was a super accelerator. Like, if we would have done this work alone in 5 years and realized this 5 years later, it would have been even worse. So it was both very destructive and very interesting. Yeah.
So to repeat the last thing, are you happy and what's next?
I'm super happy. Like, this for me, it's a dream. Like, combining everything from like hippie camping to like castle living and sleeping in the sofas inside the castle. Like, you know, like that's amazing. At the same time, like, there's people from all over. You're washing dishes with experts. You're cooking with experts. You clean the toilets and the shit from, you know, with experts and your colleagues and. And you talk about like how can you recycle shit, or can you drink your own pee through your filter, you know? Which brings me to like the next step, which will be. I wanted to do that, but I actually asked Cassandra if it would be a viral video to drink your own pee. And I think I might do it for the crowdfunding campaign, so maybe
wow.
Just
cool.
Yeah, I don't know if it's cool or too gross, but I'm super happy. Like, this is amazing, really. And next, yeah, to work with everyone, you know, like, I want to visit Berlin, come back to Paris, go to Finland, like, you know, work on maker spaces. Hopefully we do like a permanent POC and, you know, have this environment forever. Like this is a dream. So many people, so many positive people, everyone is open-hearted, and it's very warm. Like, one day we stayed, like, I don't know, until like 3 in the morning, and suddenly people were just hugging each other and just singing for, like, you know, it was weird. Yeah, but that's part of everything. Like, yeah, I mean, volleyball, playing volleyball, the slide, you know, the sliding sled, whatever. Slide. Yeah, the slipping slide. We came up with different threads because they didn't work with the 3D printing. So it's one that you turn and then you have to push. It's called the twist and snap. Yeah. Well, anyway, we started like, you know, inventing things, then, you know, being frustrated because it doesn't work. Everything, like everything combined in 5 weeks. And that's why I'm staying a few days to dismantle this because it's too much to come back to normal life. And yeah, I mean, it's been amazing. So.
Yeah, this is a big opportunity to like thank everybody that's been here because everyone that I've met has been super awesome. And like, I don't know how you can get so many cool people in one place. So, I don't know. Ask me in a year or something how to describe it. It's been really cool and okay, I don't want to get into it. I had a bicycle accident like a week before I came here and like smashed my face and broke my jaw and everything. And I came here and I was like, the first thing was like, Marguerite and Thomas were like, it's the shower guy, it's Jason. And then they radioed in and like, Jason's here. I'm like, what? Like, I've never got a reception like this before. And so that was really like heartwarming and nice. And then it just kind of continued throughout the whole time. So that's really cool.
What's next? Sleep, Jason.
Yeah, cookie dinner and crash on your couch. You know? That's it. I'll go to sleep. Can I go?
No.
That would be a good time to go take a shower when everyone's like here, so I can. There's no walls. Yeah.
No, that was a really super rich experience with a lot of great people. So now I think we need like to take some time to, I don't know, prendre du recul. I don't know the word in English, but.
Take a step back,
just to think about what we are going to do later. I have some ideas, and just in the biomimicry field, for example, I'll try to push the catalog. We will try to push maybe the platform, but we're also like doing a lot of stuff in biomimicry. We grow objects, we grow materials, we grow a lot of things. So maybe we'll try to put everything together and. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm very happy too. it was very rich experience too. For the next steps, personally, I think I will drop the kettle because it's not going in a way I'm interested to go. We again take a step back and maybe I change my mind because I change my mind often. But otherwise, yeah, we have also a lot of interesting projects on the go that we couldn't bring here because we can only bring one project, otherwise we don't have the time. but we will continue this and continue trying to show that biomimicry can be interesting.
Thank you very much. And take some time and relax now. It's over. Thank you very much. We tried that before, and the answers were a little bit different.
So thank you. This was the first half, the first six projects. So now is lunch break. I don't know, where do we eat? In the orangery? Under the tent, in front of the orangery, which is this direction. Hopla. And after, so we start again then at 2:30 And then the next half is presenting themselves of the project. So, bon appétit. So, everyone's hearing me? Cool. Welcome back. I hope you enjoyed your meal. I think for most of the participants, that was like super fancy after our 5 weeks of cooking together. And for the second part of the afternoon, we're going to see the other projects divided in two topics. And we're going to see how open source is helping us getting more autonomous and how food is tackled from an open source perspective. And we're going to have a quick overview of behind the curtains and the whole story of the actual life in the castle. Just a quick practical infos for those of you who already want to leave. Shuttles are leaving starting 4 p.m. each hour until 8. And if you want to stay, the conference will end at 6:30 and we will visit the exhibition. And after that, you're welcome to join us for a drink and relax moment after this really cool day, but intense. But before getting deep in the topic, I would like to call on stage the amazing, mythical, unlimited energy supplier, Bilal. And Bilal will make you singing for the universe.
Hello, my name is Bilal. Who here is a part of camp? Okay, great, great, great. Who here is not a part of camp and is coming to, as a visitor? Keep your hands up, everyone. Whoa, everyone has their hands up. There's one thing happening. So welcome to everybody. One of the things that I was noticing while I was sitting and hearing, there was a lot of talk about this urgency. Who feels this urgency sort of about climate change and about needing to do something? Anybody? Yeah. And that freaks me out. And I don't want to do anything because I'm freaked out. You know, I want to do things because it's nice. Who here likes doing things because it's nice? Yeah. Yeah, awesome. And I heard some of that coming up in people's presentations where people were like, yeah, you know what? I love hot showers. I don't want to take the longest shower possible. Boom, innovation. And that's a really, really lovely way to look at creating solutions to our really big challenges. So I would invite you to relax, but maybe some of you are sitting here being like, yeah, man, you know, I'm a journalist, like I talk to scientists, and how can you relax when the ice caps are melting and the polar bears are swimming in their own soup and feces and my mom's even mad at me for not doing anything about it? I'm like, oh shoot, no, relax, it's gonna be okay. And so I'd like to to invite you guys to close your eyes. I know we're all in this room, we're in a chateau, it's raining. But close your eyes, and I'll try to run you through something that hopefully can help us all relax. I see some open eyes. I know, it's scary, right? Like, who's going to jump up? Okay. And imagine the perfect harmony of the galaxies. Everything kind of in its own place, doing its thing. Even Pluto's back in the fold. Yeah, thank God Pluto's a planet. And further, everything's doing its own thing and is in the right place at the right time. And so let's open our eyes and realize something really amazing. You are now different than Pluto spinning around the sun. You are somehow in the right place at the right time. Why take yourself out of the universe? And so I'm gonna go through a fun little game. Who here likes to cook? Keep your hands up. Okay. Wow. Oh my God. I didn't need to go through too many. Who here likes designing circuitry? No. Keep your hands up. Okay. So a couple of people like designing circuitry. Amazing, right? Who here likes public speaking? Most people are terrified by public speaking. It's only second after imminent death, right? People's fears public speaking. But here are some people that love public speaking. Interesting. Okay, keep your hands up if you raise your hands once. Okay, let's see. Some people missing. Who here likes playing music? All right. I think we now have pretty much everybody raising their hands. So this is what I would really encourage you to do. Think about the universe. Think about how like everything seems like when you look out in the galaxies, everything is in the right place at the right time, happening perfectly, and you are a part of this thing happening. Your job is to realize how you can bring the stuff that makes you shine into this world of perfection. And so to make an analogy about this, what I would like to do with you is play a game that I call Singing with the Universe. And I brought up a couple of guitars. Who are you guys ready to play? I know, like, just after lunch, if we sit down too fast and, like, start closing our eyes, we're going to fall asleep. So we're going to do something a little fun. People interested? Yeah. Woo! All right. Okay. So we're going to play the game. It's an improvisational game. Who here has ever improvised? Oh, wow. A lot of you. Who here has ever had a conversation? Everybody has been an improvisational artist at one point in their life. That's amazing. I can't believe in a room full of artistry. Okay, so I'm going to play a couple of notes, and it's going to be... I'm going to sing a couple of notes, and I encourage you to sing with me, okay? And one important tip about this concept of singing with the universe that I think makes the analogy really like beautiful and subtle is when you go to a concert, and you see like somebody jump on stage and just like start shredding the guitar, and the drummer's like, and the bassist like, and they're just like leaving no room for anybody. You're like, this guy is like a jerk. Even if he's really talented at shredding on the guitar, this guy's like not the best guitarist. But when you go to a stage and you see a guitarist sitting there, and he's just like listening, he's like feeling it, right? He's just feeling. He's like, what's going on? Turn up the mic and my headphones a little bit. And then just plays. Oh, yeah, that was the one. It's our job to look into our lives. This is the analogy for Singing with the Universe. It's our job to look into our lives, see the context around us, listen to the scientists talking about climate change, listen to the drought that's happening in California where I live, and just see how it makes us feel and to feel what skills, what talents. Public speaking is one of the things that I love to do. Like, what can I do that makes me shine and makes me happy to participate? So this is let's play the game now. And the song is ba ba ba. I'm gonna try playing it on the guitar to make sure I get the notes. Can somebody hold this for me, please? All right. So I would like you to sing. Oh, I don't need the microphone anymore. This is great. Okay. So. There are no mistakes. Mm-hmm.
could keep on playing, then I could start saying something, maybe in tune. I'm looking at the grass, it's pretty green. I'm wondering when I'll look at the moon. Craters, Vader, Darth playing Space Invaders. I'm a kid from the 80s. I'm just walking and I'm wondering if maybe people will play along with me. Boom. It might be scary, but I invite you to play. I'm not staring anyway. Be yourself, 'cause that's all you can ever be. Be yourself, 'cause that's all you can ever be.
Thanks a lot. Thank you very much, Bilal. I hope everyone felt connected here, because I did. For our first part, well, first, I'm Asma. I didn't introduce myself, which is kind of rude. I'm part of the team here. So the first part of the three projects that are going to come, we will talk about how open source is helping us getting more autonomous, and how by creating digital commons we manage to steward the natural commons. And I will call Benjamin Tank, one of the co-founder of the project. And Benjamin is our, how can I call you, partners and operation god. Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Asma, for the introduction. Hi, everybody. Very nice to see all of you gathered in this beautiful place today. This was really a super strong adventure, and I'm very happy to moderate this session. Yes, I should be there to be in the camera. Good. Perfect. So this first session of the afternoon, as Asma said, will be focused on three projects which have the common which have in common to have a very strong motivation to liberate technology and the tools for people to be more autonomous, to adapt it and replicate it for their own local use, which can be many. And I will ask now the first of these three projects, which is Solar Oze, which builds a very amazing solar concentrator. So here's Hugo from Solar Oze.
So, yeah, hi everybody. I'm Hugo Frédéric, so from the Solar Oze team. So what we want to achieve with Solar Oze is to provide citizens with a mean to harvest thermal solar energy in order to produce and to run simple and low-scale industrial processes. So if you look at, one backward, please. Thank you. So this is nowadays the how looks the solar thermal for industry. So this is working. It's producing heat for factories today. It's profitable. It's efficient because it doesn't convert energy. You get heat and you use heat, so you don't lose in efficiency and in the conversions. And so it's very fine, but it's big. Like, these ones are covering up to kilometer squares. And so the idea with Solar Oze is to bring this technology to a lower scale in open source, so that eco-villages, farmers, small producers, citizen cooperatives can actually use this technology to build the product they need. Next one, please. So this is how it works. You have mirrors on the bottom that follow the sun, and so they rotate all day to reflect the sunlight towards a receiver, which is on the top. And inside the receiver, you don't see it like here, but there is a black pipe with water running through it, so that with the sunlight it gets hot and the water boils and vaporizes. And in the end, you get steam between 100 and 250 degrees. So what can you do with steam in the end? Well, you can do actually a lot of things. You can bake bread or biscuits or whatever you want. You can pasteurize food. You can sterilize food container, so you can do canned food. You can distillate essential oils or simple chemistry processes. And you could also, if you add engines, you can have electricity, cooling, mechanical power, compressed air. So we came here in POC 21 with the concept, with the ideas and the 3D schematics and all the knowledge to build one. But here we actually built our first prototype. So yeah, if we can go to next. So we finished it yesterday or this morning, I don't know. And it might actually work. We'll need sun to see that. So the next step for us is really to install some of these at some real users' places to get the feedback from the real users and improve it, and actually also develop the appliances that are needed to use it, like ovens, engines, chemistry setup to distillate, and that's it. I want to emphasize here, because I'm the only speaker, but that's collaborative work. We are an association. OSE stands for Open Source Ecology. So I really want to thank all the Solar team members here and the supporters that helped us. And we have also like 15 persons out of the castle that were involved in the project very much. So, I'm not the only one here, even if I'm the only speaker right now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hugo. Thanks a lot. The next project had built two first iteration of the BiC tractor, which is a pedal powered tractor. They built one in South America, then one in the south of France, and they came together for POC 21 to build the third and more advanced version. So please welcome Mathieu and Jean-Pierre from BiC Tractor.
Hello everybody, I'm Mathieu from the Farming Soul Collective. So we developed the BiC Tractor. What is a BiC tractor? It's a tractor that you can build with your own hand and you can power with your own feet. So why not using a regular tractor? Because on one hand, in small and medium-sized vegetable farm, they cannot necessarily afford a tractor, or they don't want to take credit from a bank. And also there is a new movement of conscious agriculture that don't want to use fossil energy machine, and that don't have the needs that fits their visions. They don't have the tools that fit their niche, their visions, their needs, and are still efficient. So we decided to build the BiC tractor, which is a bicycle but also a tractor. So We came here to develop the BiC tractor, and now I have a blank. As you can. the mic here. I'm gonna use my sheet. It's too much pressure, actually. So yeah, we built the BC tractor, and we managed here to find the best recipe. So using the best ingredient from a bicycle part, car parts, motorcycle parts, and also boat parts, and we combined it into a bicycle tractor. So before, we already built one prototype in California and a second one in south of France. They worked, but they fell apart every 2 minutes, so it wasn't really perfect. So the last 5 weeks in POC 21, the last 5 weeks in POC 21 allowed us to develop and evolve the BC tractor into a running and easy to build bicycle tractor. So yeah, that's it. So now it's no, that's not it. So now we made a BC tractor, which is running and easy to build, but it's not all. Like this is not where we stop. Actually, the BC tractor is just an excuse for us. Like the vision of our collective goes far beyond that. Our goal actually is to empower people to equip themselves to reach manufacturing autonomy. So we are growing a collection of tools that don't need anything but the people that use it. For example, we develop also a water pump, a dry toilet, and so on. So so right now we are working on the manual of the BC tractor that can be downloaded and easy to build and develop independently. So our final goal is to not be needed anymore. So that people can build their stuff without us. But at the meantime, we like to get our hands dirty and being where things happen. So we give workshops to farmers and other people to teach them how to make things by themselves and make things happen. So yeah, that's it. Sorry for all those things.
Thanks a lot, Mathieu. And now for the third project, I will call on stage before having a panel discussion together. I will call Daniel from the €30 wind turbine project.
Hi, yeah, I'm Daniel from the €30/€/pound/1,000 wind turbine. Check. So in 2013, I was in Scotland. I'd been developing a couple of low-tech open source projects, like since 2009, started with a solar tracker, which I developed over about a year and a half of like bouncing around Europe and Australia, staying like in squats and autonomous centers, just any workspace and living space that I could get into for low cost. It was all low cost, so there was no funding, there was no backing behind it. So in 2013, someone sent me the link. I think that's how it happened. I don't really remember sort of like the actual genesis story of this, but making up as I go along. Someone sent me the link on Facebook, and so Mr. Ed Lenz, who was either American or British, had developed basically that turbine, a vertical axis turbine. Wind tunnel tested it, got power curves, done a lot of all the engineering, basically, of it, which meant that I didn't have to, which is nice because I do not know how to do any of that stuff. Like, all that I do is basically take things that have been made by people who know how to do that stuff and then just make them more accessible. make them low resource, make them replicable. Sort of like just reverse engineering, basically. I'm a reverse engineer. I'm the opposite of an engineer. I undo engineering work that other people have done and make those things available to people who aren't engineers and don't know how to do stuff properly. And so the entire point is that it's a thing that you can make badly and it'll still work, because most people don't know how to make stuff well. I don't. And I've got access to, like, you know, Western world level of infrastructure and, you know, resources and stuff. So other people who have a lot less than that need to be designed for. So the numbers work out, the physics is good, it's a good design. I went in the forum, saw what people were saying who were making it, and they were like, yeah, it's a good design, it works, but like, sorry, what? Yep, okay. But it's a little bit harder to make, and it's a little bit more expensive to make than a horizontal axis wind turbine, because they're quite easy and cheap to make. But a vertical is always going to do better in anything other than perfect wind. If you're an open field with a steady wind direction, use a horizontal, it's great. Anything less than that, anything worse than that, a vertical is going to do better. So anywhere that there's houses, anywhere that there's trees or obstructions, anywhere that people live, that people work, a horizontal is not going to do very well, and a vertical is going to do well. So if I was just like, if it's just that it's harder to make and more expensive to make, then that's just design. You just make it cheaper and easier to make. If the physics is there, then the rest is just, you know, the work. So over the course of 2013 in Scotland and in New Zealand, I basically just took that design and radically simplified it in terms of how to make it. In terms of, like, in order to test it, like, it had been tested, like, in a wind tunnel by a university team or two. Me and my father and, like, the community that he lives in New Zealand didn't have access to that. We had his V6 Commodore and a stretch of country road. So we put the turbine on the tow bar of the car and, like, tore it down the road at 100 kilometers an hour, which confused a lot of farmers and truckers. And people were like, is that a wind-powered car? And we were like, yeah, mate. I'm like, oh, can I have one? You're like, yeah, right. Oh, sweet, yes. We didn't tell them that doesn't make any sense. So basically, that there is a still from the construction tutorial that I put together after getting the thing rated to 100 kilometers an hour. It's all available online. You can follow the tutorial step by step. You don't have to understand what you're doing, because you'll understand it at the end because you've made it. And then it's yours to improve on what? So I've been giving workshops on how to make that, as well as, you know, putting it all online and stuff. The materials involved are a bike wheel, aluminium printing plates, and nuts and bolts, and that's it. And that's why it's so cheap. But it'll take 100 kilometer an hour wind. In a 25 kilometer an hour wind, it will do about 80 watts of mechanical power. If you convert that into electricity, it's enough to charge phones, laptops, run lighting, radios, refrigeration, air conditioning. In the global south, it's the difference between not having any of that stuff and having that stuff. In the west, if you have a bunch of these, like on the ridge of your roof or in your field or something, you can take a reasonable chunk out of your power bill if you're somewhere windy, like Edinburgh, like Wellington. A farmer can put one of these on a pole with a water pump out of a car, mechanically coupled, which means that if they don't have access to grid power out in the middle of their field, but they need irrigation. So from here, it's a matter of broadcasting as much as possible, but also taking this out into the world, because the people who are going to need this first and most aren't necessarily going to stumble across my website. So I was 6 months in India last year, working in, not actually on this because Delhi has no wind, but I was up in the Himalayas, took a crack at it there, just doing some other things. Next year I'm going through Central and South America, again, just doing this, but also doing other things. I mean, it's not a matter of this is my thing, I'm like, you know, do wind turbines. It's a matter of going into the place, finding out what people want, what they need, what they have to work with, and then helping them design and build the things that are going to make the most sense to them. So that could be wind power, it could be solar power, it could be biomass, it could be a great many things. And that's sort of the project, which is the work itself. This is just one possible solution which can be rolled out, but there's a lot more, and there will be a lot more as
as the years go on.
Thank you. And you can stay, Daniel, because we're having the short panel discussion. So if Hugo and Mathieu and Jean-Pierre, or is it just Jean-Pierre, joining us? Yes. Perfect. Thanks everyone for your super inspiring presentation. I'm really amazed by what you achieved during these 5 weeks. And I've seen most of you, especially Solaros and BC Tractor, like from almost day one building up until day 35 or 36, like in the morning, basically, of today. So maybe one, like some of you touched that a bit, but like since we're talking about like open source for autonomy and how liberating knowledge can also liberate people and enable many applications and replications. Maybe I would like maybe you to describe maybe some typical applications or users that you have already witnessed or that you are envisioned for what you're building. Talking about the first iterations also of the BC Tractor and people you see applying it, and also at Solaros and the wind turbine. So I don't know who wants to start and why. Like basically, why do you think they are really motivated to use it right now? Like, how do you understand your users?
Hello. Then for the BC Tractor, when we built the first prototype, it was in fact in a farm with farmers who are part of our collective. And then at the beginning, we built it because people were waiting and define what they need. And that's people who will use it that decide, okay, we need that. And not somebody from up who just decide, maybe those people over there need that. And in fact, we worked like that like since like some years. And we worked like that on the BC Tractor. And in fact, we tried yesterday the first, like in a farm like this tractor. And it was a group of like 5-6 farmers, and the first reaction they had, it was okay, they saw the machine, we explained like 5 minutes, and they were talking like they were appropriating the machine and thinking, okay, I might use it like that. And they already, like, we were just there since like 10-15 minutes, and they were already on the machine trying to see how they might use it and how it might go on their field. And yeah, we try to work in that way, just to work like with the farmers when it's for farming machine, to work with them, and because we are part of farmers also, and to define what we need and how to build it, and to be able to have our own tools to build it, and to have the knowledge also, because sometimes like the knowledge is just like for people who study, but most of us, we don't have chance to study, and we want to like take that back to people who need it. And yeah, that's the main process we try to do.
Yeah, so about the users, right? The best example we can give nowadays is really like the BC Tractor team that's actually that we will in Mars 2016, we will build a solar concentrator there, because they are growing lavender. Is that the name in English? Lavender, and they produce tomato juice in bottles, you know, and they are also pasteurizing apple juice, so it's really the best usage for us. So, and it's going to be the best also experimental prototype or site to really go into the user functioning of the machine. So yeah, we're really looking for that, and we'll try to develop all the appliances and that are needed to actually work with the thing, because You need to deal with the sun going and coming and going away. So, and that might add some storage or some electronic controllers. So all of that we need to make it functioning, and that's the thing we want to do on actual working sites. So we're really looking forward to it.
I don't really have like a solid answer to that question because it's just a very generalized thing. Like it's sort of designed to be as one size fits all as possible. So like there's not really like a specific kind of like demographic or like geographical area or like type of person. It's for home use mostly, maybe like small commerce, small industry, but like and I mean by this I mean the wind turbine, I mean everything else as well. Like it's a matter of like just sort of putting it out there and seeing what happens. So it's not for me to like target a group, it's just like just throw the net as far as and wide as possible and see who makes what use of it. I mean it'll be very emergent, like what happens. There'll be like people using it for stuff if anyone uses it for anything, which I wouldn't have foreseen. So it's a more generalized approach.
And you already have a few people who have been using it for a while already, like the ones that were built.
There's a couple of wind turbines up. There is a guy and his young daughters made one from the tutorial as a family project in, I think it's in Wisconsin. And there's a project group in Argentina who are going to put them in the favelas out there. And there's a bunch left over from the workshops that are going into like a community, like urban farm in Ireland and just other things like that. And yeah. And I keep getting sort of like the other sort of main thing, which I didn't even really mean to make, it was meant as to make something else, is the reflector dish, the communications dish, which is out back here. I get emails about that occasionally, like someone like Tanzania will be like, oh, we want to like communicate over tens of kilometers, and it's like, can you make your dish? And I was like, yeah, all right, cool. Sort of forgotten that I put that thing up on the internet, but yeah, so again, things coming up that I hadn't really foreseen.
And one question I would like to ask you, the three of you as well, is so regarding the further development also of the prototypes, and I think like when we talk about like economic model, etc., I think none of you has planned to right now to make and sell and commercialize what you're building. It's more about opening the knowledge and empowering people to build their own and make their own. So maybe you can talk more specifically of how you envision to continue the development, especially maybe also Solaros and Bicy Tractor. You're working with L'Atelier Paysan or planning to work with them. Maybe you can touch a few words on that.
Yeah. We really plan first of all on people replicating it, and so it can improve, because we still have some work to perfection it. So and we hope so also that some people can maybe develop some of the other appliances that are needed, like engines and everything. So it's really up to anyone to propose a design and improve and connect the things together and have them working together. So, and that's true that we, as the association, we really want the thing to be spread and people to take it and use it. And then some of us might propose services to formations, how to build it or how to use it, or calculations ahead of what should I use with it, am I gonna be able to cook, and what kind of volumes with the seasons and the sun and everything. So it's that kind of economical model with the product that just diffuses by itself, and then if enough person uses it, you can live out of services or helping people using it. So yeah, and we intend also, when we have a really thing that works and we know it works really well, to make formation building workshops with people to build the things on the territory, and yeah, that's the kind of economical model that we see.
For us, like for the economical model, like we're not planning on selling the machine, but like doing workshops that people can build by their own, and if they need help, we help them like as a workshop. Like, okay, we come for 10 days and we teach you, we build the tractor together, and then you know how to build it. And in fact, like this tractor you can see here, we're gonna test it next year in a farm in south of France. In February, I guess, or end of January, we are planning a workshop with like a group of farmers, maybe like 10 farmers, and the aim is to build like two other prototypes that are gonna be tested next year. And then next year, we try the tractor, things that work well, it's fine. Things that might broke, we will push it very hard to make it broke, to be able to fix and to tune the tractor and to be ready for the next winter. Then winter from like in 1 year, like to be ready like to give workshops to people to teach how to build their own tractor, because there was already like more than 50 farms who are waiting for us and waiting for this kind of tools without communicating. Then we have a lot of job on that. Then we want to test like two or three tractors next year and have a good base. Also, then we are looking like for sponsors and things like that, just to rent a place, to buy tools and to be settled, to work on that, but also other prototypes we are still working on. And like the economical model will be like giving workshops as possible. If we can live out of that, that's fine. If we can't, it's okay. We are still living, doing other things, and it's not an issue anyway. And let's see what happens in the future. But the idea is to make the prototype we get like stronger and really like share the knowledge and still working on new needs and having groups of people who, okay, we need that and we work all together to maybe we are more on like the technical parts and they're more on the need part maybe and develop together like those projects. And that's how we see like the future for so far. Yeah.
So I don't know if you heard all that, but like it's very, very super exciting. The fact that when L'Atelier Paysan spread the message about Bicy Tractor, like 50 farmers already said that they want one and they want to build one. So that quite of proves that there is a need for the Bicy Tractor and people are waiting for it. So, and are willing to do workshops. And Daniel, maybe you want to share like your plans for the future as well?
I mean, in terms of money, it's a similar kind of model, like doing workshops. Not for ideological reasons, but for practical reasons. You can't control information, you can't sell information. Like, it'd sort of be nice if you could, but you just can't. I mean, it kills inventions when like an inventor tries to make a business out of their invention.
And then it's not open source anymore then.
Well, no, for real. But like, but I mean, I think, okay, well, also for ideological reasons, but like, You can charge for your time, you can charge for things that you've made. You can't charge for an idea that you had. So that sort of reduces the economic sort of like revenue basis for these sorts of things to, you can give workshops. It's a good model, that's what I do. Works really well, it's a sweet gig actually. You can sell things you've made, like kit sets, which I'll also probably do. Especially now that the turbine's CNC cuttable, because I can just send out IKEA-style flat-pack wind turbines, like, you know, scattergun approach. But the idea, the information itself has to be free. Like, and then you get models which become very self-perpetuating and, like, you know, and self-sustaining. Like, everything sort of, like, clicks into place when you try to make other people steal your ideas. And then just take what revenue you can get off the back end of that. So in terms of like personal revenue, it's easy to pay your bills. You're not going to make a big business out of this. You're not going to like, you know, make $1 million, but you'll pay your bills. And, you know, that's, you know, what else do you need, really? In terms of development of the things, like the wind turbine is sort of fairly locked down, the thing itself. Now it's a matter of getting like the applications, like pumps and generators and all sorts of stuff. I also have like a list of about like half a dozen other things I want to prototype, yeah, like over the next year or so.
Cool. And maybe in one sentence, before we need to close for the next session, What do you like? What is the one thing you remember from basically these 5 weeks, this camp? I know there was a lot of trouble to get the right materials in France. In your case, specifically, Daniel, was not as easy in other countries. If you want to share on that.
Like the whole camp in one sentence.
Yeah.
Ah. Oh, that was the sentence. In a good way. I mean, that's a good way.
Well, a lot of work, but a lot of fun as well, and yeah, great opportunity and everything.
I would say the same, like good things, bad things, like usual life, like real good things, others that need to get better, but in general it was good.
Yeah. It's more like this. Cool. Thanks, y'all.
So we've been talking a lot about building, making tools. So I believe it's time for us now to have a quick tour in our factory.
Factory, it's a prototyping facility that we set up for PSU 21. It's a sort of temporary fab lab.
Fab lab stands for fabrication laboratory. It's a place where you can find machines and people that can help you to make almost anything. There are tools to bring manufacturing close to the users and to bring back the knowledge of making things to people, which we lost like a couple hundred years ago with the massive industrialization that we are living today. So it's basically about empowering people through technology to affect reality, to change reality.
Having factory is amazing because it basically helps you test your ideas or your sketching directly. It's a good way to see what works, what doesn't work, so that you can immediately improve your design. So in the factory we have four areas. There is a metal workshop, wood workshop, digital fabrication area, and an electronics workshop.
POC 21 looks like mostly every other fab lab in the world. You can find a large-scale milling machine that can help you to cut pieces of metal, wood, which you can make from furniture to entire houses, for instance, or large structures. You can use a laser cutter to cut textiles, wood, and small pieces to make smaller prototypes or some parts of larger prototypes.
Right now we're cutting the lid for the filters, so it's like clamps in on both sides. And there's a small engraving in the middle and a bunch of holes for a threaded rod and stuff. You'll see it's very simple.
Of course, in the metal workshop and the wood workshop, we have traditional hand tools and power tools, and the digital fabrication area and electronics, it's basic Arduinos and every parts you need to make your circuit boards. And of course, 3D printers, laser cutters, CNC machine.
The Fab Lab network is 557 Fab Labs around the world. It's not only places with machines, it's about the people behind the community that is exchanging knowledge about what's the future of fabrication. And specifically, what is the future of digital fabrication? One of the keys of a Fab Lab is to have a common equipment that allows the exchange of digital knowledge on the world.
So a 3D printer is a machine that basically takes your 3D file and prints layer by layer. A 3D object. What's interesting about digital fabrication is the fact that your digital recipes can be sent anywhere and can be shared with people. So it's a very easy way, instead of shipping something, shipping objects, just shipping the recipes.
So I can design something here in Paris and I can just upload the content, and then in Cape Town in South Africa they can download it, adapt it and manufacture it with the same tools. And that happens in terms of minutes or seconds. No? Developing technology is important, but also developing the knowledge about technology. Why it is important for a city to have a fab lab, or why it's important for the future of civilization, is basically bringing back the tools for people to make things.
the future also of digital fabrication is not only about the machines cutting pieces of wood, etc. This is a transition. What is coming is that we will have fab labs that will be able to make fab labs, so we don't have to make machines in China and ship them to the rest of the world. But then the real future or the real, you know, game changer will be when we will be able to actually introduce code into materials, and instead of manufacturing things with machines, we are actually able to code an object and basically grow it. It's how nature works. You know, we are made out of information that is contained in our DNA, and it's a set of instructions that actually construct us. But then there is not external machine that is making us. It's ourselves. We contain the machines. So that's the future. That's the longer vision of what a fab lab is and why it's important to change the whole production system and to change how we have been fucking up the planet in the last few years.
Wow, we did live 5 weeks in a fab lab, and it's pretty amazing. Our next topic is essential for us, for our basic need and pleasure. It's food. And the three projects that we are going to see will explain us how we can decentralize food, to re-centralize our food production. And I will call our campaign and content expert, Daniel Cruz, who will give us some thought for food.
Thank you. Wonderful moderation. Bonsoir. Thanks for being here. I feel like some of the projects doing the mistake everybody does, sorry. you feel a little bit that they start to sink into the sleep because they've been too long in this factory. So me myself, I'm the worst maker in the room. I have two left hands, so to say. So, but I really like to become a reverse engineer. I like that job description. And before I forget, I really want to thank shortly the guys who do not spend the nights in the dome or in the fab lab, but in front of computers, cutting videos, not only for here, but for a live magazine, which will become a documentation. So a big thanks to Sam, to Hannah, who jumped in the last week, and Laurent, who left us already. Really good stuff to see and watch. Okay, and then I would hand right over to the first project, which is Acre, which is Tristan. Welcome.
Hi everybody, my name is Tristan, and like most of the other people who stood on the stage before me, I'm incredibly tired. So bear with me, I'm going to try and power up and push my last bit of self into this very short presentation. So Acre is a open source hardware project around urban farming. We develop tools around the need of people in cities are developing this movement to want to start growing their own food. And where does this come from? I believe that people are being more and more exposed to information about what's going on behind the closed door of our food production system. That's making people's eyebrows raise, and they're thinking, I'd like to participate in the process of food, to open it up, to have more transparency and more control over what I'm feeding myself and my family. So Acre is an attempt to take that idea and embed open source development inside of it, so that anyone can develop tools for people in cities to grow food in small spaces. So Acre kind of slots in, if you want to go to the next slide, between this, which is a DIY, janky, not very nice chicken coop, and the next slide, which is this, a kind of overdeveloped, ugly, expensive chicken coop called the omelet, this one. look at it, ladies and gentlemen. Isn't it gross? Anyway, next slide is what Acre does. So we basically take sheet materials and transfer them into useful objects for harboring life that can produce stuff for you to eat, or to grow things that make you feel good as a human in your house, being around nature. If you want to press the next slide. So the tools are designed, and again, maybe, yeah, the tools are designed to be super simple and to assemble with very low skill level. So you don't need any screws, any tools, any glues to put these things together. You just need 10 minutes and the desire to participate in this kind of food production. So we're trying to lower thresholds, lower barriers to entering into producing food in small space environments. This video will be quite funny for maybe some people who've seen us in the factory over the last few days, because we got the tolerances wrong, so we had to like hammer the crap out of this stuff and re-saw and sand a bit of it. But generally speaking, it comes together when you do it, when you have the right files, really fast. So the great thing about digital manufacturing is it's all it's very much computer-based technology. So we're trying to utilize the full potential of that by making our products parametric, which means you can essentially type in a different thickness of material, stretch out the design so it can be bigger or smaller, and customize it so it can fit plastic materials as well as just plywood. It can fit laser cutters as well as CNC machines, which like this is what we've been doing with these kits, and makes the design very flexible and able to fit a lot more use cases. So yeah, this video is just showing the grow wall. This is a vermicomposter system. So let me just quickly talk through the products we do. We do chicken coop. This is a vermicomposter, which is basically a worm composting system that's a lot faster than normal basic composting. Converts up to 7 kilograms of food a week, 7 pounds of food a week into really fertile waste soil. This is a plant bed that you can really easily put together on rooftops and balconies. This is footage from Denver. All of these users are reporting back happy things, thankfully, from these kits that we donated to people for this video. And so this is the grow square, the grow grid, which is a raised planter bed, multi-level, the worm house, the egg house, chicken coop, and the grow wall. We also have a beehive, which I didn't put into this video. But thank you very much. That is Acre and our current range of products.
Thank you. Have a mate, please, for the panel discussion, Tristan. Next project, right away, Own Food. Cassandra, welcome.
Thank you, Daniel. So I think a lot of you today might have already introduced myself to you, but for those of you who don't know, I'm Cassandra. I'm with the project Own Food. We are making it possible for people to reclaim their means of food production by creating gardens that are highly productive and easy to use. Can I have my next slide? We're doing this because the agricultural system that feeds us today is broken. People are forced to accept a high CO2 footprint for vegetables that are expensive and low in nutrients. But they don't see a way out because everyone thinks of gardening as something that is back-breaking and life-controlling. With Own Food, can I have my next slide? Thank you. With the Own Food system, we are changing this. We are making it possible for people to get back to the soil on their own terms. Our system makes it possible for a family of four to feed themselves in 24 square meters in 20 minutes a day. It's a huge claim, I know. Our system is based on 4 simple steps that people can follow using tutorials that we're going to provide. The first step introduces a special type of mulch, which is chopped branches and leaves from the forest. We put this on top of soil to revitalize it. Next, we introduce raised permaculture beds. These are a combination, you're going too fast, sorry. These are a combination of logs, branches, a soil mixture, and then the same special mulch. By doing this and also creating special combinations of plants, we're creating a system that is extremely passive and requires no care at all, and you can leave it and be relaxed. Step 3 is really exciting because this is where we add a connected greenhouse. This allows people to prolong their growing season and monitor what's going on inside their greenhouse from their smartphone. Finally, we put in an aquaponic system, which is a symbiotic relationship between plants and fish. So the fish are feeding the plants, and the plants are filtering the water for the fish. This takes away the need for soil, meaning we can grow vertically, optimizing space. All of these things together create the own food system, which makes it possible to do the 24 square meters for a family of four. Next slide, please. We're open source because we know how important it is for people to have transparency and trust their food production. So here you can see an image that we've actually developed with the team here at POC of our open source tutorials for the automation hardware. And here you can see an image of a seed packet, because not only do we make our hardware open source, but we also use open source seeds. They're not hybrid, they're not GMO, which means that when you plant them, they'll stay alive. Instead of dying, because that's written into their genetic code. Can I have the next slide? At POC 21, we've reviewed the sustainability of all our materials. To refine our prototype, which you can actually find our full POC prototype down the road, if you follow this map, which you can also find at our station in the dome, please come and visit us. It's beautiful. We have plants. It's a really nice environment. We've also moved forward, starting to design our next prototype, bringing in the feedback that we've gotten here at POC. And thanks to a partnership with the ACD Greenhouses, we're now going to be able to bring connected greenhouses to the world. Final slide. Right now, we are looking for pioneer citizens to help test our system with us so that we can help families reconnect to their food. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Yay. Convincing. Convincing. So, final project of the day. They had a couple of changes, especially they changed their name. So it's the new Kitchen Bee, formerly Biceps Cultivators, Audrey.
Actually, yeah, Biceps Cultivatus is still the name of our team because we are, my name is Audrey, and I'm working with three other guys that are somewhere. So our project is called Kitchen Bee. Basically, we want to change the way we treat food in the kitchen because we feel that there is a lot of weird stuff happening in the kitchen. For instance, we put all the fruit and vegetables in the fridge, but we don't even think about it. We just place it there, and then we abandon them, and then it crush, decompose, or at least they just lose their taste. So it's like not nice to eat anymore. Another weird stuff is that when you want to place some, like basil, for instance, in your salad, you just buy it in a plastic box and it comes from Morocco, then you take one leaf and you forget about it, and then it finishes as the vegetables completely crushed. So you just waste it. And also the kitchen is full of electric tools. And like every task is electrified, but the worst is that you don't even need it. It's just that there is other solutions. So that's what is Kitchen Bee about. So let me now introduce Kitchen Bee. So it's actually not a kitchen. It's a key to, it's the first three modules that we call a living kitchen. We want it to be sufficient, sustainable, and simple. And here is how it works. First, we have some sand and we put carrot inside because that's the best way to protect it. Then there is dark and fresh pots. So it's basically like a basement. And it avoids the vegetables to get the light. Then there is on top, The next one, yeah. There is on top, you can place the fruit and actually also the food that does can like stay in an ambient environment, but just needs to be protected from the flies. And also that you can look at it and see how ripe it is. Then our second module is the is more living one. We have a vermicomposter inside. So, yeah, a vermicomposter, you can change. A vermicomposter is quite an ecosystem working with worms. So you have worms in your kitchen, but it's all right. And actually, you see there is a trap. So you like cut your vegetables and just put the organic waste inside and the worms will eat it. So that's why it doesn't smell bad. And you will have some compost, and from the compost you will have a juice. And this juice is the really, really good fertilizer. So you can use it to grow food. So we use it in a soilless cultivation, but it's kind of an organic one because you use only the juice from the composter to feed it, kind of. And we choose to grow herbs because that's a really good place in the kitchen, like close to the kitchen top, and then you can also have it all year long. You don't have to buy it from Morocco or I don't know what, and you can take just only the amount you need. After that, the last one, it's a preparation spot. So basically it's a mixer, as you have like a robot, but it's not working with electricity. It's a pedal one, so it's just using your body strength, but it's not like about a sport station. You just have to push a few times, then it turns. You can like go in the dome and see it. It makes a lot of noise actually, but it works. And so, as you can see, like it's not a kitchen. I'm losing what I want to say. yeah, so. That's for us, that's the key to reinvent our surroundings. And we want to propose a library with sustainable solutions like this one. So this is the three first one, but we hope people will also be involved in it and share all the modules and other objects and solutions. And our work as designers, we want people to adapt it. We don't want to give like a final object. We want to share our research, and then we're gonna develop it for some specific kind of context and needs. But that's the first step that people can get and improve.
Thank you very much. Don't run away, you can stay. If someone could give me a hand with the chairs so we make this little setting. The floor looks awesome by now. Not white anymore, but more like the topic we have, soil over here. So, it's Tristan again. Marta in his hand, good choice. And Antoine joins us from still the BCF School of Artists team. And Cassandra, shall we mix up? All right, so I just jump right into the questions, I think. And the first one is a superficial one. We've seen a little bit in your presentation. So why is it important to grow your own food and to literally get your hands dirty again, doing your own food and being more aware about your own food? We have a plan.
Yeah, I'll start. So I think for us, this gets back to our founding story. My two team members, Mikael and Johan, they started this project because they saw how our current way of living is possibly completely unsustainable, and they wanted to create something that was lasting, that could help people be autonomous. And so with this system, now we'll be able to grow our own food. And so instead of having to create huge CO2 emissions by having food be delivered from airports and to train stations, from farms that are far away, if you want to eat organic, Now you can grow organic in your own home. So right now people have to choose between organic and local, and now that doesn't have to be a choice.
To add on to the other side of that is that urban spaces are increasingly dominated by kind of, you know, gray city walled streets that that don't necessarily harbor the biodiversity that one might want out of the space that they live in. So not only that, but using a lot of small spaces, you can actually, when you combine them, or when you all work together with your small space to make it a productive space for producing food or for producing some sort of natural resource, then you you can actually do quite a lot with many small spaces. Yes.
Makes sense. All right. Okay, second question is, we called it the nasty question because we prepared this talk a little bit. So why would people spend the time to do that in their very busy lives? I mean, you have some like time plus stats in your presentation, but are people really ready when they have these ubiquitous supermarkets all around?
As Cassandra said, it was to be autonomous again and to build our own modules and to bring life cycle back in your house, to not be dependent of the food you buy or the electricity you consume, by preserving with your fridge or using mechanical and electrical, even electronical devices. It's about autonomy, to understand what you use, what you eat, to take care of it, and to use like subtle ways and sober ways to do that.
I think in a lot of ways it's about trends. You know, it's like, is it cool to participate in food production? I think there's been this association for a long time that's been developing that farming is this old world thing and we don't do that anymore. We don't need to interface with our food systems anymore. So in a way, what I see what we're doing is a example of trying to make it aesthetically pleasing and fun to like assemble this thing that's like a Lego kit that's, you know, there's a whole element of it being playful and it being easy to access and then the result being nice to look at and nice to be around. And your friends asking, well, what is that thing? And you entering through that way as opposed to seeing agriculture as this really serious like thing where it's like, oh, I have to, you know, feed my whole family out of this. You can participate in a small way and that can have an effect on your life and on your city as well.
Okay, super. Thank you. And the last question goes a little bit into your experience here again at POC21. Were there, we've seen it with in the first panel with the electrician kind of guys that they had like collaborations or integrations. Could you share the same stories in terms of the food guys? What were the stories you shared, the learnings you had among each other?
Okay, well, I guess I'll start. Own Food and Acre have had a really great collaboration. You can see the product of that actually in the dome because the boxes that are being used to display the permaculture steps that I described in my presentation, I created with a collaboration with the Acre team. So we had some late nights and fun discussions. So that was just really interesting to have all of these project teams around and to have the ability to discuss with other project teams. I know that we also went to the energy meetings because our greenhouse uses electricity. So having so many open source projects in the same place is such a strength of a project like POC because we come together and we share ideas. So.
Cool.
Yes, about collaboration here, we discussed each person of the project, like we were searching for a long time to find something in here at POC21. What was really important is we were in a bath and then in 10 minutes we would find the expertise we need and that we were looking for maybe for 4 months before. And it was about mechanical things we solved with BC Tractor or other people. And we discussed about aquaponie, bioponie and everything. To grow our food at home with our own food or many other people. So yeah, here it was really fast to get knowledge in every domain, and this is what I would remember as a collaboration at POC21.
Okay, thank you. That was the last panel. Thanks for staying with us. And we leave you with one last video, which made up a big chunk of our lives, because we're not only working, but living, especially together, and this video shows you how.
This is a task board to ensure the co-living with all the participants. We are more than 100 persons living together during more than 5 weeks. So we need to attribute tasks, and everyone has to take his part to work on it. And we ask for each participant to subscribe to one task per week. So there is different tasks like toilet care, kitchen clean, cooking heroes, garbage crew and night guardians. So basically, this is the co-living stuff, then we are sure that we can live all together in a proper way.
At the beginning, I thought the project would be the core of the life here, and that is the core, but the co-living part is really important as well, and we built a whole community, and I wasn't expecting that.
The setup week was really extreme. We had really a lot of things to do. We were running everywhere. And the challenge was to get down, breathe, and be, you know, comfortable with the people who were coming, because it was really stressful, and we didn't want to give that kind of stress to the participants. The first thing is dry toilets, and many people were not really aware of how it works, and yeah, it's very, very personal thing, but finally there was no other solutions, so it went quite well.
I think the biggest challenge is maybe some difference in people's minds. Some people are really aware of climate issues and of everyday tasks and some small things, actions they can do, and some other are not aware at all. So we need to reduce this imbalance and to give people a general knowledge so that they know why they apply that, so know why they use compostable hygienic products, would know why we have this food and know why we have less meat.
When you have a crew of 100 people, then there's a lot of communication and the potential for a lot of misunderstandings, basically, too, and of different versions and different approaches. So it's super important to build communicational focus points where all of this comes together, that develops over the day in different smaller meetings and talks between people, and gets raised to a level for the community to work with, basically. So to make things that are implicitly developed explicit in sessions, and for that we needed a lot of moderation and facilitation to structure that a little bit and go out of this potentially very chaotic group situation, to move from individual opinions to what's actually needed and best for the community as a whole here.
It's not totally over, and before we go to visit the exhibition, and I can see that it's sunny and not raining anymore, I would like to welcome on stage Simon and Anya. Simon is our master of design and experience, and Anya, our queen of facilitation.
Hello again, everybody. My name is Anya, as you heard, and I'm part of the team here at POC21, and I will hand over to Simon.
Yes, hello. Wow, I survived. Yeah, it was really like, I think the most intense 5, 6 or 7 actually right now weeks of my life so far. I think I never got that close to the life I would actually want to live for the rest of my life, but at the same time also that close to like mental and physical breakdown, which never happened because of the great people that surrounded me, and also, you know, we surrounded each other, so when the battery was down, somebody would jump in and basically take over. Yeah, and well, there was a lot of them, over 100, as you heard, and yeah, we went on this crazy adventure to and set sails to kind of find this this land we all felt must be there, this place, this like this better world. And even though we are not there yet, I think land is in sight, and yeah, and I'm very sure we will make it to the shore, like take the last meters, take the last steps. And to do so, you really need like an awesome crew. Like I feel, of course, the best crew. The crew here was the best crew I've ever had in my life, I think. And we would like to present you some of them, who of course just stand for like dozens of others, which we cannot all bring on stage. But yeah, so far you basically just saw the project teams, but in addition to the project teams, there were like 3 times as many people supporting them and making sure that the stuff that happened here actually happened. So yeah, it was people who did night shift after night shift. Yeah, even though they're pink, bear-shaped measuring tool was missing for weeks, and who still managed the next day to pull off a half professional comedy show to lure people into toilet shifts. So people like Paul, so please come on stage. So you have to know, like, basically, I don't know how many percent, I have no idea, but I would say like 90% of all the 3D modeling work that has been done was done by Paul. I mean, yeah, it was really, so many people said, thank God that we had this guy here. So would you like to share something with us?
Well, thank you, I guess. Thank you, everyone, for having me here. It's been an incredible experience. I've met so many awesome people, so many new friends, so many new professionals, so many amazing projects. I can't believe I have to go back to the real world. Like, can we just keep doing this? If we all stayed, can we just stay? Is that... I'll try and be short. I've had an amazing time. I can't thank all of you enough. I can't thank even Autodesk enough for asking me to come out. Like, everyone on my team is super jealous that I got to be here. And I'm totally, like, you know, boasting about it the whole time. And I keep talking about how amazing all you guys are. And while I'm here, I want to give a shout out to Jason, who's been awake for 48 hours and did that shower loop. And I don't know if you guys, so when you guys saw the 3D model, when you go down to the exhibit, I put these ridiculous curvy pipes in the 3D model, and he spent like 3 hours making the real one look like the 3D. And so I feel slightly responsible for him not having any sleep. So I don't know, he's probably like out now, but yeah, Jason, I'm sorry. And again, thank you guys so much.
So we had a few families with us here at the Park Camp, and this is why I would like to invite 2 people on stage next, who actually stand for 4 people, and who've been incredibly important to like camp atmosphere, and also stereotypically maker families, I would say. Always like a kid on one arm, doing something else with the other side, spending endless hours driving, building three of the domes, building lots of stuff that you can see around here, supporting the projects, and yeah, just being there at the same time throughout the night for the little ones who are crying or needing them. So I would really love to see Kari and Kata on stage. Big thank you to you and your partners.
I mean, like, just from my side, it's really crazy, you know, when you hear people talking about, oh, it's so tough as a family, yeah, you have to stay up at night, blah, blah. But, you know, here you see families who are, like, climbing on 5 meter high ladders, fixing, like, spots in the dome that ripped overnight, or, like, building up, like, in a massive 2-week sprint an exhibition that would normally take 4 months, you know, and all that in addition to a kid and to a family, and, yeah, just amazing. So, would you like to share something? I hope, only if it's good, of course.
Yeah, I just like to say that it's been like a really crazy time because we were traveling and just focusing on family life for like a year. And then we came here and had like this amazing, like really crash into something really big and like kind of needed to work and to get like the old me and the new me, and like, of course, like Jan is also like together in here. And yeah, like the last weeks have been just crazy, like with the exhibition, and like we needed to split and somebody needed to take care, but we still figure out how it will work. But kind of it worked really good, and I'm really glad, yes, that for all this, yes.
Okay, let's see, this works. I also like to thank all the people that are not here. Like, a lot of people came back just for the exhibition, but there were a lot of people that helped set up things and build stuff. So building the dome, we had like Bruce Sterling in the dome climbing it and building stuff, and also Stefan helping us. And I also like to remember Manu. So thank you for being there, helping us with the little one, supporting everyone. So yeah. Been great.
Yeah, and then there's these people that, yeah, do not stay for like the full 5 weeks and kind of like scrape on the edge of their energy resources, but are like super valuable because they jump in and bring in a crazy amount of energy and really, yeah, kind of like push that things keep going in an incredible way. And these people were super valuable. One of them was Annalena, who I can say, yeah, was one of the people who really saved our butts for the exhibition. Yeah, would you like to come on stage, please? Would you like to say something? No? Okay, no.
Thank you. Who was that? When you get here, people welcome you and they usually ask you who you are, and you usually say your name and what your role is. So you're either a partner or you're a supporter or you're a volunteer. And, you know, partners have the money and volunteers have some skills and are really busy bees, and the mentors have a great mind and give you input. And when you're a supporter, sometimes it's not really clear. You also have some skill and you're supposed to help the projects, and you usually spend, you know, good time, and it's great fun and good work. But what was really the main outcome for me is that at some point you stop being supporter, or you stop being volunteer, you stop being sponsor or visitor, but you become part of the community, and that dissolves the roles and the borders, and that's really my main takeaway from here. So thank you all for being part of this team, this community, whatever your role was or is, and very glad to have spent that time with you.
And then Well, as you can imagine, you saw all these incredible pictures before of all the stuff that has been made. And well, we had a factory, but the teams did not work there just by themselves. There was a crazy team of supporters who helped them out with an incredible amount of love and passion and like expertise, but who like for most of the time just stand in the back row. Like nobody really knows that they're there, like they're not on stage. Nevertheless, their input is part of everything that has been made here. And there's Simon, but there's also Damien, who I would like to welcome on stage if he's here. Yeah. Okay.
Well, hello. So I guess I have to thank you, all people, for this amazingly camp. And as a designer and as a person, I had some issue to understand the open source. And I guess I have to thank you for that, because now I have faith in that. And also, I have to say that don't forget that numerical stuff, it's good. But don't forget the knowledge of the real material and of the ends. Agree. Thank you.
Yes, we can. We could say many things to many of you. Small advices. For example, n'oubliez pas de mettre du jeu. It's a private joke between us and Solar Oz. But we have a very good time with all of you, and it's true that seeing that the recipe is not all, you need the know-how, you need people to exchange, you need to, like you want to play some, let's say, piano, you will work every day to be able to make it in the right way at the right time. And it's exactly the same for a hammer, a screwdriver, or a laser cutter. Okay, so practice, and it will be good.
Just one more thing. Please bring us back the tools. Please.
There's also another group of people who's doing invisible work, and that's a huge machinery of logistics that's going on behind all of this, in addition to all the volunteering for co-living and day-to-day work that's been happening here. And basically, and it ensures that this event can happen like it's happening now. And as one example of people from this group, I would like to welcome someone on stage who you could call like the mother of the camp, because she basically cannot stop caring or taking care of things and people. She's probably shed some tears over us, but we really hope she forgives us, because basically without her, we couldn't grow up and grow together as a community. So if Donna is here, please come on stage.
Hello, everybody. Sorry, I just like. I really want to thank you. Just for being here, for example, because it's the first time. For example, we have all in here on stage, and we have all the such. Wonderful. Thank you for people that are in the logistic and invisible work. And we are a lot. There is Maiwen, there is Leana, Manuela, Int, Claudine, Julie, Yanis, Anke, Aurélie, Marion, and all the cooks that just help us every day. And I just want to share another POC moment for me. It was our role here for the logistic is often to be the bad cop with all the rules, so we can do that, we can do that, and everything. And at the checkout circle that we do every day, after some days here, it was all resident that just remembers the rules for everybody and not us. And just that is like everybody feel like we are all responsible of everything here, and it's not just the logic part that's out behind everybody. And just that's my point moment. So thank you to everybody, and welcome to another moment like that.
Okay, I guess that's almost it. Just, I think, as a small addition to the people who are not part of this camp, actually when we started it and when we started the communication, it was actually all about the prototypes and telling we will have the solutions to climate change and all of that. Well, that changed over the course of the camp. Everybody really understood, wow, this is not just about making stuff and maybe finding solutions. It's really like a kickstart of something bigger. Like, we had great sessions talking about what comes afterwards, and there was this, like, it felt like there's these 100 people saying, okay, this will keep going on. So when you go to the exhibition, don't think, okay, these are the solutions and they are the alternative to what's there. You know, Dominic already said it before, you know, basically the old industry had a lot of time after World War II, so we're just starting to build the alternative right now. But I guess you can already anticipate what's to come if stuff like that comes out after 5 weeks. So, yeah, I'd like to welcome you to the exhibition, and have a great day. Bye-bye.